Hello and welcome to Learning Music with Pat. Today I decided to bring in an unusual item for you to see. I've only had it here once before, and that was at least a year ago, actually longer than a year ago. And so let me pick it up. This is a necktie. Now I don't wear neckties, but I got the idea from a magazine that it would be a nice thing to have one because it has a keyboard on it. And the keyboard does actually play. And I can remember last Christmas, I actually bought a bunch of these and gave them to my male friends. And they all got a kick out of it because they do play. And a lot of my male friends are also musicians. So there's a little trick to this. It's run by battery. And on the back side, I'll turn it over here. On the back side, this is a little heavy area. I mean, it looks like it would if you knotted the tie in the front. It looks something like that, but it's a little heavier because there's a microphone in it and there's a place to have batteries. These batteries do work, but they've been well worn so that it's not that loud, but it still does play. So what I have to do is I have to turn this little switch on and you'll hear some noise come from it. Whoops. There it is. Now, I've noticed, this is just an aside, but I've noticed sometimes I've bought some inexpensive keyboards because I can use them in nursing homes and all kinds of things that I can use them for. And they all start off with that kind of a sound, like a little scale or a little melody, and that lets you know what's on. Now, this can be embarrassing too, because if you bring it into a regular orchestra, you should be able to turn it off and on without any sound, and the only sound you get from it is what you're actually playing. But these are built for kids, and so there it is. Now, it's on. Now, what I'm going to do, I'll make some noise out of it, and then I'll lay it down. So I'll play it, but as you can see, now let me lay it down. The only way I can really play it is to lay it down, because other than that, you're not going to be able to see it very well. So what I'm going to do, the black keys do not play. This is where you would have your sharps and your flats. The white keys play, and it's in the key of C, and it's perfect pitch. Only one note plays at a time. It's pretty well in pitch. So it's not a bad little thing. It's basically a toy. And I know a lot of my friends had a lot of fun with it. And I had a lot of fun with it too. So it looks like a regular necktie. This would be where a man would kind of knot it up. And then on the back of that, there is the battery pack. And in the front of it is kind of a microphone. So you can actually get, that's where you get the music from. So when I pass them out to my friends, some of them that are in an orchestra that I play in, they're sitting there playing and playing and playing and playing and having a blast. This it doesn't play as loud as it used to, just simply for the fact that it is, it's older now and the batteries are wearing out. I'm hoping that I will be able to replace the batteries, but I'm not sure if I'm gonna be able to do that or not, whether this will allow me to, but I hope so. Now, before I run out the batteries, I gotta remember to turn it off. Because if I don't, I will wear out the batteries. So there it is, my piano necktie. You know, this is just an aside. It's not really even important for this class, but when my first year of teaching, there was some company that for some reason sent me neckties every month. I didn't want them. I don't wear neckties. And I kept writing to them, don't send anymore, don't send anymore. And I tried calling them. Every month, without fail, that necktie came. And they weren't that great. They weren't horrible, but it isn't anything I'd be interested in. And then they sent me a huge bill. I had to pay for all the neckties that they said I ordered, which I knew I didn't. So I wrote them a letter. And I said, not only am I not paying for these neckties, but if you should send me any more, I'm going to send you a bill and charge you for rent for the storage of them, because I still had them piling up. After they realized they were going to get a bill from me for storage, because I was just holding on to them and they were using up space in my apartment, they stopped sending after that, and I never got another bill. So you have to be on your toes with, you know, things like that. Well, on the last segment, we talked about reading music. I've spent maybe a couple of segments on it, but I didn't finish it all. So I'm planning to finish it this time. So I'm going to show you first this amazing little diagram, which you're going to look at, and you're going to say, what? Well, here it is. These are all octaves. They're either three octaves or two octaves. I just want you to see it. There's no way we can pinpoint a whole lot on it because it's just got so much music on it. But it's an attempt for you to see how many octaves you can get on a staff. If you look over here, now you may not be able to notice. I actually think you can notice. I think that's pretty good. This is a low E and a high E, both of which the recorders can get. So on this line, it's basically two octaves. This here is an F sharp and an F sharp, a G and a G. It's basically going up and down like a scale. This is a D and a D, and the recorders can do that. The recorders can play actually quite a bit of music. And then you get down here, and I did put this is an F sharp and an F sharp. I just circled it. But there are some times when you can get three octaves. The flute can get three octaves, guitars, pianos, and so forth. So if we go back here, some of these octaves are really too much for the recorder to do. Like down here, it's below the staff line. The recorders can't get that. You know, the flute can't get it either. The low C is the lowest that most of the woodwinds can get. The saxophone can get like a step and a half below the low C, and the clarinet can get a little lower than that. But most of the instruments, you get the low C, and that's all you can get. So I'm trying to find one here. Okay, here's the C right here. I don't know if you can pick that up or not, but whoops, that's the C. And then here's like a mid-range C, and this is a high C. It's got two ledger lines, one through the high C, one right below it. So three octaves. Some instruments can play three octaves. The flute would be able to play this, these three octaves, because it does only goes down to the low C and it doesn't go lower than that. And so what it does is show you a range. This here is a D, and this is a high D with two ledger lines on it. And here's the F, and here's the F, which the recorders can do. This is listed as a chromatic octave, two and three octaves. You go up and down a scale, and you may be able to play some of the notes depending upon the instrument that you're playing, and other times you can't play that much. But I just wanted to show it to you. I would never try to get you to play it because most of it you might not be able to do on a regular recorder, but flutes can do it. Now, turning the page here, this is something that advanced students will run into, and they are beautiful, and they're called a cadenza. So a cadenza is just a range of notes. And there may be some time signature. This does not have a time signature. They don't all. Some of them do. Some of them will have a hold. There will be faster notes, like these are 32nd notes right here. Those are the flags, and they just run them right through the whole series of notes. It's like a scale. Then you have a hold here. You have a breath mark right there. Remember, I've told you about the little caret signs, which accentuate the notes. We have three there. So it gives you some hints as to how to play it. But basically, with a cadenza, you play what you want to play. You play it as you feel it, and no two people will play it exactly alike, because it's just open to individual interpretation. On regular music, you've got your staff, you've got your lines where the measures are and all of that, but on a cadenza, it's free-flowing, and you can play whatever you want to play with it. You use those notes, though. You have to use those notes, and you would have to follow some of the signals, like this is a hold, this is a hold. These would be faster than the eighth notes because they're 32nd notes. They're faster than 16th notes. These are 16ths. This is a flag, a double flag for all of these notes. They're 16ths. These are 32nds. So this is a little bit slower than this is. But it's basic to your own interpretation as to what you want to see, what you want to hear. And you would work with it and work with it until you get it the way that you want it. They're very beautiful. They can be very beautiful. They're just a free-flowing group of notes within a song, and they just fit in the song, and you play them the way that you want to. It's like a solo part called a cadenza. You wouldn't get into it until you were fairly advanced, but that's what it is. Now, I just want to point out major and minor. In the major keys, you have sharps. Like there's an F sharp, and F sharp, I just put, this would be a D sharp, and I just put a few in. Minor keys have flats. Here's a flat right there, here's a flat right there, and this is a flat, and since this is a natural, so that these are all accidentals. I did not put any in the key signature, I didn't put sharps or flats, so I just wanted to write out what you see. And it's interesting that sounds of nature that you hear are always in a minor key. The nature does not play anything. The sounds that nature creates, birds singing, you know, with the wind rustling through the trees, anything that's natural in nature will be in a minor key. And when we play in the minor key, we make sure that we use flats. If you play in a major key, then we make sure that we use sharps, except for C, the key of C, which has no flats and has no sharps. So I just wanted you to see that. Now, here's an introduction. An introduction can be a large introduction, a long introduction, or it can be a short introduction. The introduction is just a note, sometimes more than one note, however many you want, actually, that kind of introduces a song. It's a part of the song, but it kind of introduces a song. And so here we would have a one-note introduction, and it happens to be a D. This is in the key of D because it has two sharps. It's also in the time of 3/4 time, which is like waltz time. But I'm not interested in all of that. I just want you to see it as an introduction is the beginning of a song. Here would be an introduction, and it's three notes, and they are eighth notes, but it can be anything. I've seen introductions half of a page long, really, really long, and I've seen some songs that don't have introductions at all. But it's like an announcement. This is part of the song. The song is on the way, and we're just introducing it, and we're doing it through the intro. And this is what it's called, and sometimes it's labeled intro, which stands for introduction. And some people have it, some music has it, and some music doesn't. Grace notes are something that you may not be familiar with. They're a little tiny note that come just before another note. Here we have three of them. Here we have one. A lot of times, like, they may have a slash through it. This is like a miniature F note. It's on the F and the staff. And then there's a line through it. That means it's very, very short. It doesn't look like a line you'd see, actually. It doesn't look like a sharp or a flat. It doesn't look like anything like that. But that little slash right there, it shows you that that's a grace note. Here's a couple of grace notes right here. They're always going to be very small. So if I were to play, and I'll just take out a recorder just as an example, if I'm going to play, that little short note that I'm playing before the main note is a grace note. And there's lots of music where you find grace notes, but you always see them as being very, very small, and they're right before another note that's full length, whatever the note is, and that's it. So here's your grace note here, and you've got one right here, you've got a couple right here, and that's the way it is. So it's a note before a note. So that G was a grace note, the F sharp was a grace note. And you see that in music, they're not hard to play. You've just got to remember, you just glance and you play them quickly. There's no specific time, you're not holding them, you're just playing them quickly and to get to the next note. That's a grace note. And the trills, if you see a note, it says TR in front of it or on top of it, that means trill. And when you trill a note, you take the note and you play it back and forth. That's a trill. It can be pretty fast. It doesn't always have to be fast. So if I wrote, this is an E right here. If I trill the E, it's not just going to be the E that I play. I'm going to play it back and forth to the next note above. That's the trill. And some music has it, and they'll just put a TR. Sometimes they may use a little squiggly line, but most of the time they just use a little TR on top of it, and you realize that that note is trilled. It's not the same thing as a grace note, because you're trilling one note, and you're doing it on the next step above, whereas the grace note, you just play it and hit the note above, and you're not repeating anything. So that's what that would be. Now, setting the time. I've gone over some of this before, so I don't want to spend too much time with this, but your whole note right here, it's a circular note, and there's nothing in it. It's a vacant note, but it stands usually for four beats. It's called a whole note. And then these two are half notes where you have that stem down, and they're still clear, but you have the line up or down, and those would be the half notes, and that's usually two beats. Then you have your quarter notes. You start blackening in the notes now. The whole note and the half note are the only notes that are clear. When you start getting into the quarter notes, they're blackened in, and they're all going to have stems on them. The only ones that does not have a stem on is going to be the whole note. And then you see a dot. When you get dots are usually worth half the value of the note that just preceded it. So if this is a whole note, which let's say it's four beats, the dot would say add half again the value to it. Well, half of four is two, so this would end up by being six beats because you're adding two beats to that. This is a half note, and then it's going to end up by being three beats because half of a two note is going to be one note, so you're adding that one beat to it, so you get three beats. You can get dotted quarters. You can have dotted eighth notes. This is a dotted eighth and sixteenth, which is used a lot in music, and that dot means that eighth note is just a little bit faster, a little bit longer, and this is the sixteenth note that it's attached to. So, you know, there's all kinds of ways of reading music. There's all kinds of ways for writing music. Now, the slur or the hold, I got to watch my time here. We may not quite finish with this today. The slur or hold, it means the same thing. You play and you tongue that first note, and it's attached to another note. And instead of tonguing that other note, you just hold the note over as if it was one note instead of two. So here's a dotted half. This would be three beats. This would be a fourth beat. But instead of tonguing it, even though it's in a different measure, you hold on to it. So you're actually making that note that you're playing one beat longer. And that's the way it is. Now, here's an example of a slur. It's a small curved area, and it goes from one note to the other note to the next note to the next note to the next note. And you would hold all those notes. So here's a half note, half note, half note, whole note, and this is another whole note. When I say whole note, one beat note is what I mean. And you would tongue that, and you would just hold it. And then when you come to the D, you play the D, but you don't tongue it. It's like attached to all of these other notes. So that's the slur, or that's the hold. And I want to mention repeat signs. We use them a lot. Here's a repeat sign. It's like two lines and two dots. And where does it go? It goes back to another repeat sign that has two lines and two dots. So when you play this, you get to here, and then you go back and you play it again. That whole part is repeated. That's the repeat sign, and you go back to a repeat sign. Now, sometimes if you're dealing with like the first line of music, that may not be there, but you still go back there because there's no other place you can go back to. But most of the time, you will actually go back to another repeat sign and you play it again. Only once, though. It's repeated only once. You don't keep on going back and keep on going back. That's just what it is. And when you get this little slash and these two dots, this means play this again. And so I've got three of them here. So that means I would play this, I would play it first the way it is, and then I would repeat it three times. First repeat, second repeat, third repeat. But I could make it a lot easier, and I could take one repeat and put a three on it. Three on, and that means you'd be playing it three extra times. I wouldn't have to write it down all the time. There are different ways of doing it. Now here, what I've got is, I've got the measure, you play the measure, and I've got this repeat, and I've got four. So that means I play that once, and then I play it four more times. I play it as it's written, and then I add however many times that I want to play it or that the composer wanted to play it. So I would play that really a total of five times. Play it once, repeat it four times, instead of writing this measure four or five times. I see. I'm going to have to close it here because we are running out of time. So I'll finish this next time. I think we can do it next time, and I'll have it all finished. So I hope you'll enjoy this and learn from it, and please join me next time.